your time. You have to just be there for other people, giving your attention and just bring the message of sustainability in all different areas, because it's not just sustainability in fashion, right? For me, my passion is that people get inspired to make a change, to make choices that they are informed and knowledgeable rather than just whatever by any product. We are in an age and time that to do whatever it is, you know, with the internet and all the amount of information that is out there, we cannot ignore anymore. There is no way we can continue ignoring. So you're doing so much with all of the organizations that you're involved with. And I would like for you to just take on the mic and talk to us about what is it that you're doing in your life.
Well, first of all, I just want to thank everybody for being here. And they're the ladies that were on the stage earlier today and asked really wonderful questions of our designer. But anyway, why don't y'all come sit down? No, but thank you for being here, and thank you for being interested in sustainable fashion. I was really shocked when I watched a film called The True Cost. Has anybody seen that film? Everybody needs to see that. You can download it, stream it from Netflix. And it really opened my eyes to what's going on in fashion. There were a lot of things I didn't know. 3% of all fashion consumed in the U.S. is actually made here. 97% of it is produced in developing countries. And just a year or so ago, I don't know if you've heard about it, but there was a factory in Bangladesh where 1,000 workers, primarily women and young girls, were working. And the managers are men, usually. But the workers complained about cracks in the concrete, and it was multi-story. And the business owner didn't, you know, spend the money to repair the building, and the building collapsed, killing 1,000 workers. They were just buried in the rubble. And the problem is that this fast, what they call fast fashion, used to be 2 or 3 seasons. And now it's 52 weeks of the year. There's something new, trendy. It's this, you know, like this planned obsolescent fashion. So the dyes don't last. But, you know, it's very trendy. It's very expensive. And there's like, the markets become so competitive between, you know, these different companies in developing countries that there's not enough money to pay the workers what they should be paid, and to do the repairs, to make the workplace safer. So we really need to analyze the situation, be aware of what we're consuming ourselves, and also make our children aware. I have an 18-year-old daughter and a 21-year-old daughter, and they like to consume this fast fashion. You know, the cheap, trendy clothes, but the more you can teach your daughters about the reality of sustainable fashion, and you know, where some of their clothes are coming from, then they become sensitized and empathetic, and they won't, you know, they won't participate in that. And then also you've got, you know, our young girls thinking that they need to be something that they're not. They're not happy with their bodies. They're not happy with their, you know, they don't have the self-confidence and the self-esteem. And in a lot of cases, you know, the fashion industry is selling them something that is supposed to make them feel important and fulfilled. And just this downward cycle of consumption is what they're getting back. And you know, I think, you know, D'Amico said that the fashion industry is the second most polluting industry outside of oil industry in the world. And it's like growing cotton in some of these countries. 25% of all the world's pesticides is dumped on cotton fields. And, you know, the workers are not protected. A lot of it is getting into the water supply. There's like thousands of other chemicals used in the production of the textiles. A lot of the colors are made with heavy metals, mercury, and cadmium, that are getting into the water supply in China. For instance, they're having really bad experiences of the health of the people and the health of the communities because of this. But I am, you know, so I'm learning about sustainable fashion. I mean, we all learn on the job, right? But my primary focus is that children's health, their quality of life, and their future. And there are a lot of things to consider. What is the old adage? Think globally, act locally. And a lot of moms, or you know, people who work, they have to think about how they can fill in the gaps in our own community. And our water, our air, our soil, healthy soil makes healthy food, our biodiversity, all of this is really important to our young people and future generations. And in a lot of cases, we're so busy. You know, they say that our children are spending between 8 to 10 hours a day in front of some kind of screen. When I was growing up, I was always in the outdoors. The worst thing I could possibly hear was my parents calling me in for dinner. You know, we were always outside, so we connected with nature. We understood the importance of our life support system, what God gave us, our air, our water, all the critters, the forests, whatever. And so we became stewards. We understood that it was important to preserve and protect those things. And so the gaps that I saw in my community, a lot of you see in your own communities and are working hard to make a difference. But our water, you know, there was raw sewage coming up in people's homes and their basements and their yards. And we needed to upgrade and retrofit our aging and antiquated sewer system. So we started a Riverkeeper program. You have a Baykeeper here. And it's really important to have that one person dedicated 24/7 with their eyes on our lifeblood, our water. And so anyway, that was 20 years ago. We sued the city of Atlanta, you know, the stakeholders, and won that lawsuit from the Supreme Court and set national precedent. And all of a sudden, our mayor, who became known as the sewer mayor, a great African-American woman, that raised $4 billion in bonds to retrofit, expand, upgrade our sewer system, and now our water, as a result, is 90% cleaner. Yeah. So it's really good. Started Mothers and Others for Clean Air because we were the asthma capital of the country. We were number one back in 2000. And then we became an official program of the American Lung Association. And it's really important what the American Lung Association is doing because they realize that not only cigarette smoke, antigens and certain things inside your home can be a root cause of asthma or a trigger for asthma, but it's also dirty outdoor air from burning fossil fuels, from the transportation sector. So we have to be aware of what dirty outdoor air is doing to our children and to protect their lungs because they breathe a lot more air. They take a lot more air, a lot more pollutants for their body size than adults do. And we found out that dirty air permanently impairs lung function. It's not something you can get back once you lose it. And so we have to be responsible, our air, our water, and then we also, with the food in the southeastern